to take what belongs to you before cross over. Grace, the grace will take what belongs to you and what is yours before crossing over. If I am right, I believe we have 2 days to cross over. Today is the 29th.
Yeah.
We've had the 20th and the 31st. And the next one will be the 1st. We need a grace to cross over. And not only just a grace to cross over, but a grace to take what belongs to you that the enemy has kept for so many years and so many times. That's why I cross over to take it along with you. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Grace. Let me start like this. There was a debate between Christians. You know, when I sat there and saw something going on, I went to read it, something going on. I was arguing and putting you a problem. I was the work and I was rooted. You know, give you a chance to forget your mind of what to think, what to believe, what to feel in yourself. Amen. So there was a debate going on about Christianity. What makes Christians stand out among all religions of the world? And the first person said, it's because Jesus Christ died for our sin. So all the religions believe that Jesus Christ died. So, and you know, it doesn't make anything. It's because Jesus resurrected that also. And it's not that I do it. And this guy is going to see that Lewis. He's a great defender of the Christian faith. Read so many books and spoke on so many occasions. If you're fortunate to God, you're fortunate to have him in the midst. He asked, well, what is the argument when I explained to him? He said, well, it's very easy. There's no one thing that makes Christians stand up among any other thing in the world, any other religion, and that thing is grace.
Amen.
Grace. He said, it is the grace of God that got you sitting there. It is the grace of God that picks you and turns you around. It is the grace of God that allows you to see the day. If you have not been the grace of God, you will be history. In fact, you have been aborted in your mortal room. Then you will be a miscarriage. It will take the grace of God to bring you where you want to be. Hallelujah. So grace is your step up. When you talk about Christianity. Hallelujah. It is unlimited favor, something you don't deserve. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
When you look at grace, you look at a coin has two sides. The first side, that side of the grace talks about salvation. The grace of God is salvation of the world. Hallelujah.
Amen.
You are saved. That's the second part. The second part of grace is what you need to live. What you need to walk in the power of God as a member of the church of the earth. Because let me tell you something. The world we live in is controlled by altars.
Yes, sir.
The White House in America is controlled around altars.
Yes.
Everywhere you go, altars speaking. And that's why as Christians, if you don't have an altar, you are a wasted Christian. When you go to the shrine, you place the sacrifice on the altar. And the release divination in time on those sacrifices on the altar and something happens. Yeah. Because they believe in your altar and your altar is speaking for them. If you must be successful in 2020, you must build an altar to the life. Yeah.
must be an altar for your life.
You cannot live another day without an altar. I already know that there was two young men. One was Paul and one was Paul. Paul and Colin grew up together to be best friends. And all Paul knew, Colin was so a great man, a great friend. All these years, they went together, went to school together, ate together, married together, even the marriage of sisters. Very close. Paul believed in Colin. But Paul Colin has had a pretty agenda. He was not truthful with his relationship with Paul. All these years, Paul believed in him. All these years, Paul trusted him. Not until this day, Paul got his visa to travel to America. The first person he told was Colin, his best friend. Man, I got my visa now. Wow. The people you always talk to, I'm jealous of you. Hallelujah. Every good thing has come to you and not me.
Paul said, well, I thought about this. You know, when I got it for you, you're going to be the first person I will send for. I need my wife first, but you're going to be the first I will send for.
In Jesus' name. So what are you talking about this? He said, oh, don't mind, I'm just praying. But he could not really pray. He had a healing agenda in Jesus' name. He went in the house and sat down and celebrated. He allowed the pastor on the table, the other one table, and they were there talking. They asked one day, grab that pastor and spray in your pocket. Nobody knew where he went. If I didn't think of the pastor and his visa until 2 days for returning town, pack it up. Can't even know where is my pastor. He looked around, he can't sound. Turn about pastor like that. You went to you go call your next door. Call you, I can't call my pastor. The pastor just can't look at me like a panic. Turn it on upside down. Look at the way. Out of frustration, the guy said, you know what? But tomorrow, this time, if I don't come back, I'm just going to die. And then she said, Paul, I'm calling you what author he was sent for. He was back, so that the day she said, the author was looking for this. This guy sat down, and his wife came for work. He was so confused, so distressed, so troubled. Honey, what's going on? He didn't talk. Honey, what's going on? What are you doing like this? He didn't say a word. And the last thing she said, this is not true. And he said, it is not possible. I don't know. I had it here. I can't find it. Did you see my pastor? He said, well, what's going on? The pastor was right on the table there just yesterday. So why haven't the pastor come on this room for you? He said, I'm not looking for you. So come on up here. They stopped the woman to give the pastor and then he's not there. The woman said, this is not me. He said, well, this is not me. The gospel in this house cannot just disappear. Something is happening here. That was my pastor. So I told my pastor, he said, pastor. I went my pastor and he said, pastor, you my pastor. The pastor gave me my passport. He said, I'm talking about this thing being not normal. This is not the will of God. This is not what God has said. This is the hidden work of the enemy. That's in the pastor. And then we talk to him and go on babies, pray with the pastor, and the pastor people talk to him and when God into prayer, the first thing the pastor saw is that, my young man, there is an altar that has been speaking against your life.
Mm-hmm.
For years, your life has been tormented by an altar. And thank God for grace that I have brought you here today. The grace to be served by the family. And the pastor began to pray. They began to pray for him. The pastor went back to his father's house. Went back to his father's house and began to be stressed and became a spirit man. And after an hour of deliverance and prayer and prophecy, it was done. Go home. Go home in Jesus' name.
The man said,
I think my prophet, he just prayed, but where is the prophet?
I said, pray home.
What? I didn't care what he said, pray home.
I'm just praying that you're on the right. And the same thing I'm telling you.
I told you that this man was on my prophet. And you know that?
Amen.
While he was on his way home, private minutes in his house, his friend calling me to run to him, crying, oh my God, until another altar speak, altar will destroy the man. Hallelujah. You must have an altar. I will speak for you. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
God controls the world. God controls man. Time for let me know that there was an altar built between Timmy and the Deport. The altar was a covenant that existed between them. I can't survive, you can't survive. You will protect me, I will protect you. Establishment between Jonathan and David in the presence of God, and I honor that. And Bible says when Jonathan became king, the father of Jonathan was produced by Saul Jairus, Saul, and the tempted to kill David or kill Christian. In Jesus' name. And pray to kill David, the little will be buried. The little will be buried. Because what? Because of it. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And David will escape. In the pursuit, the man got David. And fortunately for him, the little will die. Now, I was talking for him. What year am I doing? The praise of God. This person is very much in the army. Saul was an enemy to who? He attempted the life of David on three important occasions to kill David. And every attempt he made never came to pass. And David had the upper hand to kill him. And David refused to touch the anointing of God. David refused to lay hands on Saul. That's not Saul, whether he dead, he desired not to defy Saul. Listen to me. You will have enemy in your life that does not give your life to act, will never happen. God is your defense. God is your defense. God is your defense. God is your defense.
Yes, sir.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Your battle is on your knees. Your battle is on your knees. Listen to me. Those that need your God to do that, and the people are small, just small, small, just small. Hallelujah.
And it's also small. Hallelujah.
So, press on your knees. That you're missing by many of you, many of us are here. If you ever heard that the person who will kill you is dead, you will come back to you. You will come back. You will celebrate them. You will celebrate. Oh, thank God, the evil of my anger. Bible says, David can remain many of those. They went and cried to Saul. Not only that, he took his gun up and ripped it into pieces. Hallelujah. Yes, they went away to kill me and I'm sorry for him. Now, they're not only just sorry for Jesus, they said, you are also weeping for God. The same father, who was the enemy. When they slap you right, turn around, rest. It doesn't mean you are stupid, it doesn't mean you are coward. Let it bless you that you are too good for them.
Yeah.
Oh man, that's a good thing that I understand. Let it bless you that you are too good for them.
Yeah.
They will not understand.
Yeah.
I slap the man when you tell you that.
Yeah.
What?
Oh, yeah.
Yes, I'm getting it.
This man of here is a person. I trust him to understand this. Now, there's a young man who was a gangster, had one of the biggest guns in New York. He stole him in life. This young man picked up an attitude from his childhood. He was mistreated by his mother. He was mistreated by his father. They were all brothers. And they had no,
Kamara.
He was the gun chief in New York. There were only two people in his life that told him something that changed his life. The first one was a psychologist. He said to him, my young man, the life is heaven to either life imprisonment when you die and go to hell. And the psychologist told him that. You can say the life is our plan to imprisonment, and you will stay in prison, die, and go to hell. The next person that tells you something was Castle. The young man, God will love you so much. He spit up in the man's face. That is love. I've never seen love before. I never understand what you call love. Everybody hates me, and that's what I hate everybody. That's why I'm going to kill everybody I come across. What are you talking about? I don't believe you. He said, God loves me, and I love you so much. He spit it on me again. He slapped the pastor. He said, I love you so much. He said to me, even if you take your knife or whatever, you cut my body into 17 or 18 pieces, my body will say, I love you so much.
Amen.
My body will say, I want you to love you so much. She said, and if you please forgive my life, allow me to bless you.
Amen.
And the way I love you, I have Christ love you more. He cares about you. It doesn't matter what you think you are, he loves you. He can change you. You can have eternal peace. There's a war for me in front of you. And the only way you can find peace is when you see Christ as your Lord and Christ.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
He got mad in the spirit. He said he didn't know why he didn't kill the pastor.
Uh-huh.
He still can't understand why he did not kill the pastor. Mm-hmm. I don't know that.
Amen.
He got mad. He left the place. He started thinking about for weeks. He left himself. First time when he went, he get the word love. Even as he found the red pill and destroy the man, he said, yes, I love you. I'm going to say to somebody here, God loves you. I want to say to you, he loves you so much. He cared about you so much. He loves you so much. He loves you so much. He loves you so much.
Yeah.